Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to my session about hydrogen engines and the new complex pressure wave supercharger. What can be improved by using a complex? So let's work around it. You see the complex with all its in and outlets, and you will see that you can look through in a certain position. Now, but if you can look through, this doesn't mean that there's nothing inside of a complex. Inside the complex you find a rotor with many channels where gas dynamic action is taken. What are the advantages? So first of all, we have very fast boost pressure response. We have high boost pressure already at low engine speeds. Its electric driver is used only for synchronization compared to the engine speed, and can be used for power recovery as well. We have lifetime lubricated bearings, so there's no impact on engine, no blow-by, no thrust bearing needed, very reliable. All the yellow marked pieces here in this slide are very useful for hydrogen engines. Further advantages. The pressure wave supercharger compensates every operational heat. So no overspeeding like you find it in turbochargers for high altitudes. The pressure wave supercharger already absorbs the engine noise, therefore only very simple exhaust system without any heavy mufflers is needed. We have very high compression efficiency at low engine speeds. We have no surge limit as usual by using a turbo compressor. Again, everything that is marked in yellow is very useful for hydrogen engines. Further advantages. Low back pressure allows reduction of fuel consumption. If needed, the catalytic converter can be arranged between the engine and the pressure wave supercharger, which leads to a quick light-off and much less emissions. High EGR rates are easy to represent. Also very good suitable for downsizing and downspeeding, means less fuel consumption. No kind of costly compressor and turbine maps applicable. Simulation must work with a physically 1D model. Again, everything that's marked in yellow is very useful for hydrogen engines. Of course, disadvantages. So, need for small back pressure on the low pressure part requires larger exhaust system cross sections. Same for air intake part of the pressure wave supercharger. The cold start behavior of the pressure wave supercharger is a bit more difficult to master in gasoline engines, gas and hydrogen engines. Thanks to the new concept, significantly improved. Matching is more complicated, but can be done now with advanced simulation software such as AVL Boost or GT Suite. Let's have a look on the working scheme of the pressure wave supercharger. So we have a part where the rotor is inside. We have connections from hot gas and cold gas. And what happens now? So we have two parts in the charger. One part is the high pressure part and one part is the low pressure part. The low pressure part is for scavenging the rotor. The high pressure part is for pressure exchange and for boosting of the fresh air to the engine. Here you see marked in red, these arrows mean that it's the hot gas coming from the engine, and there's a so-called gas pocket valve, which is similar to a VNT, means variable nozzle turbine of a turbocharger. You see the flow, there's fresh air coming from the intake, and the fresh air is compressed to the engine. by the hot gas that comes from out the engine. And in the end we have a scavenged flow of hot gas and fresh air that goes into the exhaust system. Here is a little animation from Aerial Boost, where you see on the left side the pressure exchange and on the right side the mass flow. Red is the hot gas, blue is the fresh air. So we let it move. What you see is only one channel of the rotor that moves along all these channels in the casings. And you see here the pressure exchange coming. And you see here also the flow and the scavenging of the rotor itself. You see also that there are two cycles here working. So in one revolve of the rotor we have two cycles that work for our pressure wave supercharger. Lower emissions. So how to get lower emissions for boosted engines? Therefore, the catalyst position upstream or downstream, the boosting device is very important. To guarantee 100% working catalyst, the working temperature should be above 400 degrees and more. Here you see a scheme of the catalyst position. So you see the catalyst here, upstream, the pressure wave supercharger. On the other side you see the turbocharger turbine, where the catalyst is downstream, the turbocharger. So it's clear that the temperature level is higher upstream, the charging device, and you will have a faster light-off. So in very useful, in fact, for a hydrogen engine, because this engine runs at lower exhaust gas temperatures due to high lambda level and high pressure ratios. What happens if we take out one operation point where we have upstream 500 degree and the pressure ratio over turbine of 2.3? There you see the red line where we have the 400 degree, our working temperature for our catalyst. And if you draw the temperature downstream the turbine over the efficiency, you see the more efficiency you have, the less temperature you get downstream the turbine. Means your catalyst may not work properly. So temperature after turbine depending on its efficiency. So this is a conflict, because on one hand you want to have high efficiency because you want to have high pressure ratios. On the other hand, the catalyst may see too low temperatures to work properly. So second point is the lower back pressure with this configuration of the complex that leads to less fuel consumption, which is synonymous for less emissions. Means the pressure loss in the catalyst itself due to the smaller volume flow in the high pressure part, and the back pressure is also not additionally increased by using a turbocharger turbine. See this example here. Imagine you have pressure loss of the catalyst and the mufflers multiplied by the pressure ratio of the turbine. This will end up in higher back pressure. Then you will find it with the pressure wave supercharger, where the catalyst is upstream the charging device. In this example we find 4.2 bar, but this can end up in 8 bar. So more power with complex. So one of the most impressive point of complex is the power increase, especially at low engine speeds. What does this mean for the measured H2 engine of Professor Eiselseder? So simulations compared with the measurements show the following for the twin PFI version. If you draw the BMAP over the speed of the engine, you see in the configuration for the complex that we have an increase of BMAP up to 250%. And we stay always above the BMAP of the turbo engine. For the turbo engine, for speeds lower than 3000 RPM, a small VNT turbocharger was mounted. And for speeds above 3000 RPM, a large VNT turbocharger was mounted. But even with this, you cannot reach the complex at all. So this shows the potential of what the complex can reach. There's more torque combined with a fast response that opens more possibilities to save fuel even with more driving pressure. And it's easier to control, like a turbo system where you have borders like surge line or rotor speed. But how to achieve this in the future? And what is better compared to a turbocharger? I wrote a long list about known turbocharger drawbacks versus the complex. So you see, high boost pressure at low RPM of the engine, there's a yes for the complex, no for a turbocharger. Absence of surge line, absence of overspeed problem, absence of turbo lag, absence of oil losses. Everywhere yes for the complex and no for a turbocharger. Only that the turbocharger is not back pressure sensitive itself is a plus for the turbocharger. Then we have quick catalyst light off, any mounting position, lower system weight, no mufflers saving space, multifunctional system in one device, low back pressure to engine, more reliable, and the one day physically modeling is possible. Everywhere yes for the complex. I know for the turbocharger, of course. Common technology, yes for the turbocharger, no for complex. Result score is 12-2. Let's go for the complex technology that we are using now. So first of all, we have three new inventions made here. So first of all, the aluminum exhaust gas casing, EGC, water cooled, a two-part rotor, and a switchable working cycle. So the old versions of PPC Comprex and Swiss Auto Hybrex, they had some bad cold start behavior because of huge gap in the charger between rotor and housing. There we had steel-made exhaust gas casing with up to 1050 degrees that led to damages, and the whole pressure wave supercharger was growing after some time, which caused larger rotor gaps again. Bearing were not tensed enough against exhaust gas flow. So here you see a scheme, where you see the red arrows here, so due to a hold, a large gap of 0.6 millimeter, we had a huge leakage from the start, from the beginning, high temperatures, and the old charger rotor was in one piece and expands only towards the exhaust gas casing. Here you see a little animation. So what you see here are some red balls that come to points where they should not get, and this was due to the old system. So let's talk about aluminum exhaust gas casing, water cooled. So what does this mean? So this allows that we can put the bearing inside, and therefore we have the system of the two-part rotor possible. So the material is much cheaper of the casing, you don't need nickel. No heat deformations can lead to leakages or any damages of the casing. So let's have a look on the scheme of the new one. So we have now constantly small gaps between rotor and casings, and the rotor expands to the middle gap in between both parts. See the gaps on the right side between the exhaust gas casing the gap in the middle, in between the rotor, and the gap between rotor and air housing. So everywhere we see small gaps. And that's good for the efficiency of the pressure wave supercharger. Coming to the two-part rotor. So the rotor gaps are easier to control, and system is more dense against mass flow losses compared to the past. Let's have a look on the scheme. Now we have small gap with relative speed to the between rotor and to the housing on both sides. And new is the gap of the rotor in the middle that comes close to zero at high temperatures. And the small gap is independent everywhere from the further temperatures. And there's no relative speed in the gap between the rotor halves. Here we have a little animation. You see the water cooling of the housing. You see the bearings left and right. You see the rotor parts, and you see a scheme where the rotor part of this side is growing to close the gap in between the rotor halves. So what happens in between the rotor cells? So if you look at the wave propagation in each rotor cell, then you see this passes the rotor gap area, and in this part there is no pressure difference. There's a small moment of around 0.14 milliseconds where you have a pressure difference, and there you have a small mass flow shift while this pressure difference occurs. And that's it. You have only a shift. The mass flow is not lost. Switchable working cycle. Oh, shift characteristic of charger to low flow modus. What will this mean? You will see soon. You don't need any edge shift, and you have a better cold start behavior. So in the old version, always both cycles were running. You see this here in the scheme. We have also a little animation where you see, okay, hot gas is coming now, everything is dense. We have the compression of the airflow. In the new version, one cycle can be closed, similar to some sequential charging. So what does this mean? Again, we have a little simulation. Now this is as it was. You see there's only low flow in both cycles. Efficiency is not so good as it could be. And now we will close this flap here, and you will see an increase of the density in this part of the rotor here. So with one cycle we can increase the pressure and efficiency. So what's new? Here's some comparison about the old and the new concept. So now we have water-cooled aluminum exhaust gas casing. We have a cycle shift, like a sequential boosting system. We have a splitted rotor, we have capsuled bearings. We have individual variable gas pockets, which includes an engine brake. We have no edge shift anymore. It was very complicated. Casing geometries are not influenced anymore by temperatures. A very important point. Electric driver is the same as it was. And we have only a speed variation that is very small, because we don't need to accelerate the rotor anymore like it was in the past. Coming to testing. So the new complex is not only theory, as I've shown you here. There are several chargers that have been built and tested. Important, that's why I want to mention it, is the usage of a roots blower that is used in the high pressure path to make sure that the flow that comes out, the boost pressure from the pressure wave supercharger, also goes into the hot gas inlet. So normally this is not guaranteed if you test the charger like you do it on a turbocharger rig. Problem is, with the existing hot gas rigs, this can be done only with a hot gas heat exchanger that can handle higher pressure levels also. Here you see such a hot gas heat exchanger in photo. So our complex is this little part here on the upper right corner. From there comes the flow to the roots blower, and it comes back from the roots blower, going through the heat exchanger, where the hot gas comes from the burning chamber. And in this way you can test it to get really thermodynamical results. So there we had promising results. The middle rotor gap has only a small influence, we found out. So this is what we thought in theory, but it was really the case. No hardware failures occurred, so there was no melted exhaust gas casing. And now Comprex Evo 3 is running successfully on a gas engine and shows very high low-end torque and low emissions. So we are happy to see that. So in summary, more power where we need it, low-end torque. We have less emissions and fuel consumption. We have less system costs, we have promising testing results, and it looks like the Comprex is built for hydrogen engines. So don't hesitate to ask any questions. Our email is mail@androva.com, and thanks for watching.